cannot begin the work to build new economic systems until we take off the mental shackles of the old ones. So let your shame fall away, and remember your pride in learning and growing and loving life. Hold tight to those feelings as you set clear intentions about how the future must be different than the past. I'm Sarah Murphy, and I'm a woman who is invested in making the world a better place through education. And my master's degree really was in educational leadership, politics, and advocacy, but it was really in systems of American power and the way that those fall on the backs of teachers and students. So lots of heavy stuff, lots of really big things. And I moved to New York for that master's degree in August of 2014. My classmates and I were often struggling with these huge ideas that were going on and these huge, like, crushing systems of power. And then what do we do within the education system to do anything about them? Within these big systems, they seem immovable and unshakable, but really they're just made up of individuals. So that's why I love education. Thinking about the individual way into changing these systems is first getting our own heads right and then helping other people to get their heads right. And so I was just reading through articles on Facebook trying to think about all these things, and I found this article by Joe Brewer called "The Mental Disease of Late Stage Capitalism." And so he was claiming that these systems, that most of us who are invested in changing them, who have decided that we want to make the world a better place rather than choosing a path of least resistance where we can just get money and feed into it, we end up feeling a lot of shame for not being successful enough or not being able to make ends meet, or being crushed by student loans, when really it's not that we're not succeeding, we're just bearing on our backs the load of the system that we're living in and the system that we are all a part of, which is this capitalism, the hoarding of money in the few, and then the rest of us producing all of that. So that got me thinking about shame, right? It's like shame is really, I think that shame is at the heart of so many, just all of these bad things. Shame is what propels capitalism. Living in New York, I ended up changing my appearance a whole lot over the last 2 years. I lost like 20 pounds, I changed my hair, I like changed my wardrobe, all of these things, and I didn't realize I was doing it, but I was doing it gradually. And then I come home and the response from most of the people here are like, "Whoa, you look like hot, wow." It's either you look great, and then that's a whole nother issue, or you look so different, who are, like, take a second to recognize me. So then I was thinking about, like, why did I do that? Like, I was transforming my mind, I was putting all this information in my mind, but really, it was this feeling of inadequacy in one way or another. So it was, I'm ashamed of what my hair looks like naturally coming out of my head, so I'm gonna change it in order to fit this box of what a successful woman looks like. Or I'm gonna change my wardrobe because I have to look the part. And that got me thinking about the industries that these propel and the inequities with huge profits for makeup companies and clothing companies and workout clothing companies. That's a system that rewards paying into that self-doubt and punishes trying to figure out why. So I'm trying to, like, work out this way about reducing the things that I'm ashamed of and just trying to be, like, radically whatever I am and not apologizing for any of that. So I'm a woman who is trying to get back to being unapologetically human in a world that tells me not to. So in New York one day, I was just, like, depressed. I was on the train and I saw that somebody had painted over the ad on the train, and it said, "In a society that profits off of your insecurities, liking yourself is a radical act." And it's so true. It's like, if I just accept who I am and don't buy into that stuff, then I'll be able to get my head right and be able to let the work happen. Because I never really worry about being able to flex my intellectual stuff, because, like, I know how to do that. But learning how to, like, have that emotional equanimity when you're feeling so, like, dragged down by all of the systems, the, like, weight of all the things you're trying to work against, is exhausting, and that's a whole different type of thing. So then it's got me thinking about unpacking all the things that I could potentially be ashamed of, and, like, recognizing that and owning it and trying to express it it's okay to just choose whatever is good for me. Radical softness is pushing against that shame of having emotions. It's pushing against the idea that being emotional or having emotions or having negative emotions is a weakness. So you can reach me at smurphotos on Instagram, S-M-U-R-P-H-O-T-O-S. Or I'm searchable on Facebook through my name, Sarah Murphy. Though there are probably 1,000 Sarah Murphys. Is it still rolling?
Yes, absolutely. Oh.